For example, if I give you, well, for simple computational example, I give you a formula for f. Right? So what would be the formula? Well, the gravity law, right? So if I have a mass, the mass z, mass one, massive object of mass one somewhere here, and I put another object of mass one somewhere there, what is going to be the force, gravity force, acting on this object, attracting it to the first one? It will be dependent on that distance, right? So it will be something like what? Gravity constant, some constant, yes. Some gravity constant g divided by the distance, what? Squared, exactly. Now, what kind of vector field is there? Well, this one object, right, that I fix, generates this whole vector field. It would attract any point from anywhere with certain strength. Well, if I put coordinate system there, I can figure out what the vector field is as a formula. So, if this point is positioned at the point x, y, then this direction is direction of the vector x, y. The opposite direction is the direction of minus x, y. So I know now the direction of this vector, and the magnitude is right there. Right? So now if I divide this by the magnitude of x, y, this will give me direction toward the origin. And if I multiply by that, g divided by, what is radius? Radius is the distance from origin to that point. Radius squared is square of that distance. So square root of x squared plus y squared, all that squared. Well, this is the vector field I have. This is a formula. And g is gravity constant. You may forget about it in mathematics, right? Make it one. So that's the formula. This is your vector field f. Now my question is, does it satisfy any of these four statements? Does it have potential energy? Now, how would you check this statement for that specific formula? Would you run around taking all possible regions, integrating over all possible regions, and checking that the integral is zero? Well, good luck with that. And also checking that it's independent of path, well, it's probably unrealistic, right? So you have to look at these cases. And then you have a choice, right? One thing is to try to find the potential. And we practice that, right? So you take the x component, you take the y component, take antiderivatives, partial antiderivatives, and try to match them. And you were successful in case the formulas were polynomial. Now, in this case, it's not polynomial, it involves some square root. And how successful you will be matching two formulas, well, I don't know. But that formula is very simple, it's straightforward. It says that you have to take these two components, well, x divided by square root cubed and y divided by square root cubed, take derivatives of the first with respect to y, of the second with respect to x, subtract, and see if that is identically zero. If it is always zero, and you can check it with Wolfram Alpha. Right? I did it this morning. It says the answer result is identically zero. So you check that and you conclude your vector field is potential. You don't know at that point what the potential function is. Well, you still have to do some work to figure out what it is. But you can definitely conclude immediately that you have independence of path, and you have integral over any closed path equal to zero. And that is, well, this is of great consequence, right? Remember the conservation of energy statement? That I cannot do perpetual motion. Because I would really like to have a closed path and to move a particle so that vector field does some work for me. So that I move it repeatedly and get some work out of nowhere. And this computation basically says that for this, for gravity vector field, it is impossible to create such a path. I cannot possibly hope to create such a path, whether small path or large path, here or there. I cannot create it anywhere. Now, what about using potential energy of, well, the work of gravity of Earth and simultaneously the work of gravity of the Moon, right? When I have two vector fields added together, will I get, possibly, perpetual motion? And this is exactly the time when additivity comes in place, right? I'm asking, what if I take this vector field and I add on top of it another vector field, totally unrelated, Earth and Moon? Well, then, the fundamental thing under all these computations and calculus is the additivity, right? So the whole calculus stands on this additivity idea. So if you assume additivity, then integral over the path of one vector field plus the other one of the sum is equal to the sum of two integrals. And if two integrals separately equal to zero, the sum is equal to zero. Right? And now I'm making my conclusion under assumption that the Earth creating gravity field around it plus Moon creating gravity field around it together create a vector field which is exactly the sum of those two original vector fields. And this has nothing to do with mathematics, right? This additivity in practice, it is purely experimental statement. If you believe and you check with computations, you check with experiment that that's indeed how it works, for gravity here, gravity there, they add up, then this whole thing applies. Fundamental theorem says it's impossible to create perpetual motion. But then, you know, what about electricity? But you know that electricity follows exactly the same pattern, right? Electrostatic forces have exactly the same expression for the force, and therefore they have exactly the same expression for the vector field, and therefore the same conclusion holds for electrostatic forces. And even if you put them together, right? If you assume that a charged particle is pulled toward the Earth and simultaneously pushed away by some charged particle here, well, this particle is acted upon by simultaneously gravity and electrostatic field. That can be a complicated situation, right? But again, additivity says that, and this is what we assume, that gravity and electrostatic forces act independently, and they simply add together. And then the integral of electrostatic force plus gravity force is going to be sum of the integrals, and each of those individual integrals are going to be zero because the vector fields created are conservative, and that's it. So you cannot possibly use gravity or electrostatics. And of course you can explore further. Can you use magnetism? Right? Oh, anyway, so there are questions, and this is fundamental, exciting topic in physics.